lift wings, reflect the stars, and climb the door to salvation. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some long forgotten words or ancient melodies. He turned to me as if to say, hurry, boy.
Here we are down in South Africa at Stellenbosch with Graham Smith, who's a long-term Tiger Moth operator and a Royal Air Force QFI from the days of old, and he's going to talk to us for a short while about the hazards and the differences of operating a Tiger Moth on tarmac with no brakes but with a tailwheel compared with grass. So what would you say are the main differences then, Graham?
The big story is A, we don't have brakes, and I know of no Tiger Moths in South Africa that are fitted with brakes. We know the Canadian ones and other places in the world where they're fitted with brakes, but that has never happened here. And as you've seen on the video, the walk around video, we have a tailwheel and no brakes, and on tarmac there is very little retardation. So taxiing the Tiger here is quite an effort of planning and planning ahead, because the biggest thing is that we cannot stop the aircraft on the tarmac, and it's vitally important that the idling speed is down to 600 and as low as we can actually tolerate, so that our residual thrust is minimal. If we find that we're going too fast, then what we generally do is take a wheel off the hard and onto the grass, the rough grass on the side, and that is what helps us stop the aircraft. When we actually need to stop, we look for a grass clump, and we'll show you what I mean by that, a grass pod, and try and position the wheel up against that. Then that allows us to increase the RPM so that we don't get any fouling of the plugs and keep the airflow going through the engine, and also obviously not to move forward.
So what do you do about taxiing downwind?
Okay, obviously we need to zigzag. We need to keep the taxi speed as slow as possible. Look ahead all the time and look at what we, an escape route if we need one, should we have it. Onto the grass is always good, and generally the grass does stop the aircraft. But as a last resort, the hands near the ignition switches, so that if we are losing control, to stop the propeller, and that will also help stop the aircraft and obviously minimal damage.
So you've got to have pretty good attention then to what's going on, and can't relax by the sounds of it, Graham.
Not at all.
Thank you.
So here's the steerable tailwheel on the back of the Tiger, but of course there's no rolling friction. However, the aircraft does steer quite well. But if you watch Graham taxiing the aircraft, you see how he needs to run the gear onto the grass to slow the aircraft down. Here it's actually taxiing downwind. So a good knowledge of the verges and the runoff between the taxiway and the grass and any obstructions is absolutely essential. In this clip, he's actually rolling the right gear in the grass to provide some friction. And then when he's ready to move forward again, he just eases the throttle forward and rolls onto the tarmac. Of course, a very good lookout is absolutely vital when taxiing on confined pavement. You can see the rudder moving as he steers the aircraft around the various fairly tight taxiways on this airfield at Stellenbosch. A around very confined areas, it's most important to actually guard the switches and be ready to put them off whenever you need to bring the aircraft to a halt fairly rapidly, and very important to keep your speed under control.
Now, Graham, I've asked you to say a little bit about propeller safety. I know it's something fairly dear to your heart. Can you tell us the old cautionary tale?
Okay. Thanks, Nigel. At least I can speak from experience and bad experience. You saw the little signboard earlier on saying beware of the tiger. Well, I can tell you, I've had to learn the hard way, beware of the tiger. And that's a hand that was nearly smashed off by a propeller that I didn't even swing, I touched. And I'll show you the reasons when we walk around the aircraft why you have got to be so careful around this propeller. It has to be absolutely treated as always live. And I cannot emphasize this.
Just to tag on to what you were just saying, is that that's why, if you remember, as Graham has quite correctly said, we always treat the propellers as live. Because if there is a fault in the magneto-earthing system, that the thing is ready to go and will bite, and it only needs to be just over compression for the impulse to fire, and off it goes.
In my case, the engine wasn't even on compression. I'd got in and got the aircraft out in a hurry, and inadvertently, when I drained the fuel, I knocked on the ignition switches, and then went around to the other side of the aircraft, put the chocks in, and I had a valve which was giving a problem, so I just touched the propeller to try and move it past the dead cylinder, and it started. The only thing that saved me was that we had the chocks in position and we had the throttle fully closed. Otherwise it would have been a much, much worse story, and we probably wouldn't have been able to tell you the story today.
So we're going to have a look at some film that was actually shot on 2 days. The first sortie is looking at a fairly blustery crosswind takeoffs and landings, which was filmed on our first day. So we'll have a quick look at those. And then a second day, which was flying around the mountains with a few forced landings. So, chocks away, and off we taxi for our first trip. Graham cautiously weaves down the taxiway, keeping a good eye out for other traffic and slowing the aircraft down by rolling the gear onto the grass verge. And as we taxi out, you can see they've got some quite interesting aircraft here. The Western Cape has a significant problem with summer fire hazards, so they keep a bunch of firefighting aircraft there, which are fairly unique to those that are kept in the UK. So as we taxi down past them, we're going to have a quick look at some of those. Now this is a fairly blustery day with a good 12 to 18 knots at about 40 degrees off the strip, 45 degrees off the strip. So it's operating right at the aircraft's limits. We're going to have a quick continuity break here with a very quick bit of ground school to make sure we know what we're going to do before we take off. With the model, the wind is from the right.
So the aircraft all the time is wanting to do two things. It's wanting to weather cock to the right, and it's wanting to drift off downwind. So we line the aircraft up with the runway, put full interwind aileron, so full right stick over here, smoothly open the throttle and keep the aircraft straight using the rudder. Once the aeroplane's moving, then we lift the tail to the tail up takeoff attitude, and once the aircraft's at flying speed, it will fly away. We're aiming to lift the aircraft off cleanly off the ground into the climb. Don't let it dawdle just on the ground getting light, because if you do, the aeroplane will start drifting off downwind and it will skip and it will try and touch the wheels down, and then there will be a rolling effect.
In fact, there's some merit in having the tail slightly higher than normal, such that when the aircraft is ready to lift off, you can rotate it cleanly clear of the ground.
So it's a clean takeoff, clear of the ground, climb away. Once the aircraft's climbed away, then we can straighten up the rudder and adopt the crab climb to hold the runway center line as we climb out. Conversely, going at the approach, then we've got the problem that the aircraft is crabbing as it comes down to the strip. Remember, we don't use the low wing low technique, as we might hit the lower wing with a low wing biplane. So the aircraft is crabbing and we make the aeroplane fly a wheeler landing with a tiny bit of power on. Will make it easy. You don't have to have power on, but it will make it a lot easier if you just have a little trickle of power. So the aircraft comes down to the runway, we flare, kick the aeroplane straight, and at the same time put into wind aileron to hold the wings level. Wheel the aircraft on, and as the main wheels touch the ground, check the stick forward just about an inch to hold the tail up. Smoothly reduce the power to idle, and now concentrate on keeping the aeroplane straight, and as the aircraft slows down, progressively ease the stick forward to keep the tail up. That way the tail is in the airflow, or the rudder is in the airflow, for the maximum time to steer the aircraft. As the speed reduces, the tail will drop, and as the tail skid touches the ground, pull the stick hard back into your tummy, and that loads the tail skid, which will help keep the aircraft straight. Do not relax on the rudder. Keep the aeroplane straight using the rudder and full into wind aileron. The advantages of this wheeler technique is it keeps the rudder in the airflow and also the ailerons at a low angle of attack, so they're effective for as long as possible during the slowdown. Once the aircraft is in the stalled condition on the ground, then the ailerons are completely ineffective. One of the problems of crosswind landings is that you might well get a gust from the right. And what we're trying to do is to stop the aeroplane from being blown over like this. As you can see, there's quite a large amount of the lower surfaces of both sets of wings are exposed to the crosswind, and that's what tends to roll the aircraft away and risk hitting the downwind wingtips. If you find that you've run out of aileron completely and the aircraft is starting to roll away from the wind, a useful technique is to use the large amount of weight that's high on a Moth up here. Because if the aeroplane yaws to the left, it has a tendency to roll to the right due to the high centre of gravity. That can be quite useful if you run out of all ideas, in that the aeroplane is starting to lift the upwind wing. If you put left rudder in at that stage, the aircraft will start to yaw a bit and help to right the aircraft back onto the main wheels. It's easier done slightly earlier than later. Obviously, if you've got high obstacles down the side, then it may not be a technique that you can use, as you're going to run into something. But if on most runways where you've got some room to manoeuvre, a little bit of rudder in away from the wind will help to right the aircraft. So that's using this high centre of gravity to help us. Conversely, and this is what Graham talks about, and we'll talk a bit more about later, is that it's important to have the aircraft going straight, because if you start ruddering the aircraft around and losing control of it in yaw, what happens is that you get this high centre of gravity effect that destabilises the aircraft in roll as well. And that's what has the aeroplane starting to go unstable and, as he describes it, some kangaroo antics. It's an instability in yaw, just the same as you get PIO in pitch.
Back to South Africa then, and we'll do it for real. Graham's first problem is actually to get the aircraft lined up without it ground looping, weathercocking as it goes through the tail to the wind position. Once Graham lines up, he needs full right stick, bit of left rudder to keep the aeroplane straight, smoothly opens the throttle, keeping the aeroplane straight with rudder, wings level with aileron, and lifts the tail to the takeoff attitude. First approach, fair bit of turbulence from the trees you see on the left of the frame. It's a wheeler landing, so tail up with a little bit of power on. Once into the smooth, he flares the aircraft, kicks the aircraft straight, full into wind aileron, and then once on the ground, smoothly reducing the power. Let's look at that again. keeps the aircraft tracking center line until the flare. Kicks the aircraft straight, full into wind aileron. And as soon as the main wheels touch, check the stick forward slightly to prevent tail going down and smoothly reduce the power to idle. So kick the aircraft straight, full into wind aileron, stick forward as the wheels touch slightly and smoothly reduce the power. And now it's final last landing, wheels on, stick forward slightly, full into wind aileron, reduce the power to idle, keeping the aircraft straight with rudder and full into wind aileron. Do not relax until the aircraft comes to a halt, as it's at the slow speed that the aircraft is most likely to ground loop. So keep your concentration right up until the aeroplane is almost stationary. Looking at this still, we can see the aircraft has just touched down and the full into wind aileron being selected. The aircraft's on its wheels, power's being taken off, and the stick progressively moved forward to keep the tail up. The following morning, the wind eased off, and so it was an excellent day to go flying in the mountains. As you can see, it's beautiful scenery under the Cape, but quite rugged as well. So, despite it being so pretty, there are actually very few places to land in the event of an engine failure that wouldn't be fairly catastrophic. Even over the flatter vineyards, where the fields look good, they are in fact covered with stakes which hold the vines up, so definitely not a nice place to force land. We are on our way to a beautiful private strip owned by Richard Friedman at Mawson Vineyard. We're going to revise and practice some forced landings. So here we are approaching High Key. We're going to be landing at this end of the strip in the direction the fuselage is now pointing. We fly into wind at about 2,500 feet, and it's up here that we check that the engine hasn't stopped for something stupid like we've put the switches off. So emergency checks, fuel off, throttle closed, and switches both off. Concentrate on flying the aircraft. Make sure your harness is tight, and we're now in the position to turn crosswind, routing over the, or just upwind of the upwind threshold. Remember that our initial aiming point is a third of the way into the strip. So Graham takes us crosswind, and then in a continuous curve, routing around towards low key. And he's aiming for low key, being quite close into the aircraft at about 800 feet AGL. And you can see that he's got the strip just inboard of the wing struts. He's slightly low already, so he's starting to turn in and he's judging his constant sightline approach. When he thinks he's low, he will turn in towards the strip. When he thinks he's high, he'll turn away from it. Graham is constantly making small adjustments to keep his sightline angle correct. A quick check of the speed, 62 knots, that's good. Are we going to get in? Yes, we definitely are. And the first two approaches are going to be to overshoot. So that would certainly have been a successful forced landing. Graham has now climbed away and repositioned back towards low key. You can see the strip. At the moment, he's in a slightly left turn between the struts. He's a little bit wider and a little bit lower this time, so he's already commencing the turn round, continuously monitoring his sight line and adjusting his angle of bank to put him a third of the way down the strip as the touchdown point. He's looking at which bit of the strip is going up or down in the windscreen, because the bit that's staying absolutely constant is where he's going to hit. Once your initial aiming point is assured, you could sideslip to bring your touchdown point back towards the threshold. And again, another successful forced landing pattern. Do remember that whilst he was flying 62 miles an hour, it might be wise to have another 5 knots, particularly if the engine is seized, as the rate of descent can be significantly larger with the engine stopped than with it windmilling. So this time we're going to actually roll out onto the strip, land and backtrack for another takeoff. You will notice that Graham keeps ruddering the aircraft to keep it straight, and only when the speed is right under control does he turn it round. Again, a good weaving taxi to keep an eye on the obstructions out by the wingtips, and backtracking into the turning pan to set up for another takeoff. I'll leave you to enjoy the very scenic view, but if you're down in the Cape, a trip to the beautiful Mawson Vineyard and restaurant will be time very well spent. And don't forget to purchase a few bottles while you're there.
I thought I might like to add just a few final words on crosswind technique that goes for takeoff and landing, and it's pretty common application in both instances. The most important thing of all is to keep the wheels tracking straight. If you don't keep the wheels tracking straight, you involve all sorts of dynamics which interfere with any other control forces that you might do. The most important thing, and you can see it whether it's an airliner or whether it's a light aircraft, if you don't keep the wheels tracking straight, then you're going to involve all the instability. And you can see this when an airliner lands and the guy still has crab on when he touches down. You see the blue smoke off the tires, and that's because he didn't actually track the wheels straight. It doesn't matter too much on a tricycle undercarriage, because at least this stability rights at the center of gravity is ahead of the wheels and it runs straight. When you start the takeoff roll, most important of all is line yourself up with the runway, open the throttle gently, and make sure that your nose is tracking straight. Do not allow it to deviate under any circumstances. The next control is the ailerons, and it's important to lead the aileron into wind. If the wind is from the right, put the aileron fairly hard over to the right. You can always reduce the deflection, but make sure that you're actually leading with the aileron. And once you've got that happening, the aircraft's running straight, the wings are level, then we raise the tail as soon as is practical. By raising the tail, we reduce the angle of attack of the wind on the upwind wing, and that minimizes the amount of aileron input that we need. So to sum it up in very, very gentle terms, it's keep it straight with the rudders, keep the wings level with the ailerons, and then when time comes to lift it off gently, keep it tracking straight, and then gently relax the rudder and allow the aircraft to crab into wind. Conversely, when you're coming in, we've got the nose out to one side or the other to take off the drift. As we flare, rudder to keep it straight, obviously the secondary effect aileron, aileron into wind again to keep the wings level, and when the wheels touch the ground, they must be tracking straight. If they're not tracking straight, then we start all the kangaroo antics and the dynamics of that lead up to a ground loop.
So Greg, thanks very much for flying us around today and putting the South African side on the film. And this isn't your airplane, it belongs to two of your friends, so maybe you could say nice.
Thank you very much to Shane Oberholzer and Trevor Milton, who share this aeroplane, and they very generously share it with us, which is a great privilege.
So that's the ethos of this. Thank you to Shane and Trevor for letting us do the filming down here. Thanks, guys.